Coming up on this episode of Outlook TV, Venus Envy, a documentary on the House of Venus.
Squirrel Friends.
The Surrey Court's Drag Brunch. And much, much more.
Hello and welcome to Outlook TV. I'm Emily Ann Fraser.
And my name is T. We'd like to thank the Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh Nations for the honor and privilege to film this episode of Outlook TV on their traditional unceded lands.
Outlook TV is a queer magazine news show that brings you the stories that matter the most from coast to coast. Kicking us off, we have Ollie, who's going to tell us why we should be having some Venus envy.
Here's a documentary on the House of Venus and Wigglefest.
The iconic House of Venus is uniting here today for the 30th anniversary of Wiggle and the premiere of Venus Envy, the movie, where we're going to see all of the legendary catwalks, dance, drag performances that have happened at the Wiggles over the years.
I am Cotton, and I am the house mother of the House of Venus.
Wiggles started way back when in Windsor, Ontario, when me and my friends from the House of Venus would visit New York and try to bring that energy to Windsor, Ontario at that time, because we were already doing parties and stuff, and we wanted to create something kind of like Wigstock, but our own, where we were already designing our own wearable art. So it was like, let's do a festival, let's call it Wiggle. Wiggle. It was born in 1994. Wiggle is a wearable art drag performance extravaganza. It's basically a platform to express yourself and look as wild and imaginative as possible using your own creativity. The House of Venus is the art collective me and my friends started way back in Windsor to kind of like create positive energy and to do what we wanted to do and create safe spaces. And I mean, we've done so many things with the House of Venus, a media house, a drag house, a fashion house. And it kind of is explained in the film Venus Envy, all of the different facets and means of expression. In a nutshell, it's, you could say, a drag house or an art collective. When we started, we were professional party throwers. We never really stuck with that term.
We were super inclusive, and so it was like the House of Venus was like a real combination of, you know, a lot of straights, gays, trans, you know, people of color, which were hard to find in Vancouver at the time. And it was just like nobody thought about it. It was, you know, we had. In these the last years where you hear a lot about female DJs and this and that, we had female DJs all the time in the 90s. We didn't even think we were doing anything that was different. It was just how it was. Total house music, like real house music, which obviously came from like the black queer clubs in Chicago and New York. I think that alone, I mean, it alienated some people who weren't into it, but there's a lot of people that were into it. There's a lot of people that traveled and saw these things in other cities. They were really fierce, and it was like, you know, again, this like supermodel 90s vibe. Runway, we always had a runway, and these supermodel-esque drag queens were working the runway while I was playing this like fierce house music. So I mean, honestly, it was like a mini New York.
Years and years ago, I met the incredible House of Venus people who embraced me and welcomed me in to take part in their amazing events and all their parties. And their Wiggles. I was in the first Vancouver Wiggle. I'm going to be walking in the fashion show in a little outfit put together by myself and Charlie's Charmed and Olivier Selvas Artiste. Awesome bitch as well. Did my hair. And then I'm going to be performing as Freddie Mercury.
Forward 25 years later and it's still happening. It's amazing.
To check out the House of Venus on all social media to know where this movie is going to screen again and to know all about the upcoming Wiggle events. For Outlook TV, this is Ollie in Vancouver.
Coming up next, our squirrel friend Angus catches up with an LGBTQ liquor company.
Bottoms up.
We're at the Fountainhead Pub in Vancouver's Davie Village for a promotional event for Squirrel Friends, Canada's first 2S LGBTQIA vodka. They're also going to have a drag show here with some of Vancouver's top performers. Let's go see more.
My name is Jeremy, and I'm the COO of the coolest new LGBTQ plus 2 owned and operated liquor company. We're Canada's first and only, and we're Squirrel Friends. We are an inclusive vodka company bringing amazing and sexy cocktails to the masses. And so the whole premise behind the whole Squirrel Friends story is that Drag queens hide their nuts. And so that's why we call them squirrel friends, because squirrels also hide their nuts. Our product is actually made in Kelowna. So it's a locally made British Columbia product. It's gluten-free. It's a triple distilled vodka. And unlike a lot of the flavored vodkas that are out there, ours are still at 40%. So we kept that the standard across the board for all three of the products that we have out right now. Okay, so Fountainhead Pub, they're amazing. I just want to start by saying thank you to them. They've really, really been a huge support to our business. They were the first bar in British Columbia to carry our product. And we're super stoked to be here because we're doing a drag show with the Alchemist magazine for Vancouver Cocktail Week. So what we do is we give a portion of every bottle sold back into our communities that it's sold in. So in British Columbia, the money that we donate stays in British Columbia. In Alberta, because we're in Alberta as well right now, it also stays in Alberta. So we want to give back to the communities that are underfunded and that need the help. And being that we're an LGBTQ+2 company, we wanted to make sure that we really gave back to the charities and organizations in our community that needed our help. Our organization that we're working with is Community. They do a lot of work with LGBTQ+2 youth and giving them safe spaces, counseling, help with transitions. So one of our biggest missions is to raise money for them. It was really important that we gave back to them and were able to support our community and our youth that are growing and going to be the next generation that are going to take over from us and do the next amazing things that we need in our community. So in the communities that are selling our product is the communities that we want to help support. So if there's organizations or community groups, charities that are underfunded and really need our help, we want them to reach out to us and say, hey, if there's something that we can do to help you, because we would love to be able to help as much as we can. And so anywhere that needs our help, we're willing to help. And if we're not there, and we're not in Ontario right now, but there's an organization there that really needs our help, we're happy to like get involved in any way we can and help start to support them now before our liquor's even there.
For Outlook TV, this is Angus Pratt at the Squirrel Friends promo at the Fountainhead Pub in Vancouver.
What? We're going to have to take a little break now, but we'll be back.
We'd like to acknowledge that March 19th, 2024 is the Indigenous Two-Spirit Day.
Hi, my name is Androgynous and you're watching Outlook TV.
Welcome back.
We're catching up with the Surrey Court next. They're telling us what their plans are for their upcoming coronation in May.
Do you like drag and do you like brunch? Well, we are catching up with the Surrey Court's Drag Brunch to find out how their year has been, as well as what the plans are for their upcoming coronation in May.
Begbie's Tavern, who have literally opened their arms and allow us to come on into a safe place for free and raise some money. This past year, it was a slow start. So on this brunch, we had the amazing Androgynous, who is my prince. We also had Alter, who has been part of the DMS in Vancouver for quite some time helping out. And we've also had a little newcomer that's been coming out a little bit more, whose name is Sassa Fresh. She's a little spitfire and everything. And it's a little bit of everything. We have drag kings to drag queens to in-betweens and everything. It's just an open space for everybody and anybody.
I used to always go to see drag shows with my mother when I was younger. And so I had already gone out to the shows out in the valley, and that's where I met Miss Adrian. And it was really early after I started drag. I think it was only about 2 months in. I went to go see one of the shows out of drag. And Miss Adrian came up to me and was like, there's something about you that just kind of keeps drawing me in. And like, I don't even know what pronouns you use. And I was like, well, in drag, it's he, him. And from there, she brought me in and I was performing with them. And that's where I met Vonda, where we bonded, and she asked me to be her prince. My responsibility is to be the shiny pony. I am to perform and bring attention into the court, because being such a small court, they really wanted something new, fresh, and energetic to bring people in to come and see and support us.
How has your experience been?
It's been really good. Vonda is absolutely wonderful. Like, she's everything to me, and I love supporting her. She's so supportive of me, and I love the fact that we're doing so much good for our community, as well as just other people who don't even know about us, but we're still helping.
Now, what about your stepdad? How are plans coming?
So I've really pushed forward. I'm glad to say that we were able to make it only $50 to come on down. We'll have little bits of food and stuff like that on each table, because my theme, of course, this year is What's the Tea? A Garden Affair of Pink Decadence. And it's just literally going to be like you're having tea with the queen. So I'm looking so forward to that. That is also on the Mother's Day weekend on the Saturday. So I just feel it should be a celebration of everybody and everybody's work, because every one of us are our own shining stars in one way or another with what we're doing.
Amazing work, Your Majesty. For Outlook TV, my name is T.
Yoga? Mexico?
Squirrel friend, get your head out of the gutter. It's actually Mario with our next story about Canadian Chris and his nude yoga in Mexico.
I am here in beautiful Zipolite, Mexico to meet with Canadian yoga instructor Chris Chirin to talk about nude yoga. Let's meet him.
I found that there was something about yoga that was magical, that spoke to me, and I've never been an athletic person. When I retired, I decided to give myself a yoga teacher training as a gift to myself in retirement. I had just had two spinal surgeries and felt that my recovery was exceptional, not only because of an excellent surgeon and excellent physiotherapy, but because I had a strong yoga practice going into the accident and maintained a yoga practice after my surgery. The following year, I came to Zipolite and did a 2-week nude men's yoga retreat here, and then returned home to start my yoga teacher training. And I went on to do now over 700 hours of yoga teacher training, much around anatomy. And this gives me the skills to read bodies as they walk into the room, get down onto the mat, and develop a class that meets their needs. My partner and I have always traveled. And for the last number of years, I always look for a yoga community wherever we traveled. So I've ended up teaching yoga in Bangalore, Mysore, and Goa in India. Here in Mexico, Merida, Zipolite, and Mexico City. And next week, I'm teaching yoga in Guadalajara. I've also taught in the south of France. When asked about why teaching nude yoga, it came to me slowly. I've always been very self-conscious about my body and was the last person to get undressed, let's say. The best gift I can ever give to someone is the permission to feel safe in their own skin. And so when you are on the mat, just you, your body, no clothing, no designer labels to hide behind, no baggy clothes to hide behind. It is simply you, your practice, and your mat. And for many men, this has been incredibly liberating. Last year, I've had 3 men in particular start the process of coming out of the closet. They are older men, men who are married and have children, and it's been a very, very difficult process for them. A third man who has a girlfriend and has been married in the past began classes as Al, and he is now known as Alice. And the nude yoga classes gave them the permission to become in touch with themselves, to realize that they're good enough and that they can strive to be the best they possibly can by becoming in touch with who they are and what they are.
This was Mario Langlois in Zipolite, Mexico for Outlook TV.
We have to take a little break now.
Oh.
Oh my God, just go to break already. I don't know.
Hi, I'm Cheyenne Rouleau, the playwright behind Sunrise Betty's, which premieres at the Russian Hall this week. You're watching Outlook TV.
You came back. Hello. This next story has us wondering why people ever join gangs. Well, I have the scoop on this one. It's the Sunrise Betty's at the Russian Hall in Vancouver.
Hello, viewers. Picture it. East Vancouver, 1972. An all-girl gang takes on a prominent mobster in an epic turf battle. It's a Zoo Presents Sunrise Betty's taking place at the historic Russian Hall in Vancouver. Check it out.
Where are the others? Where are the other two?
They took a walk.
Well, go get them. Now.
What the fuck is going on?
Sunrise Betty's is about a female gang living in Vancouver in the 1970s on the east side. It's based around the real history of Vancouver with our park gangs that existed in the 1960s and 1970s. And in this particular gang, they're sort of at the crux of the introduction of heroin into the scene, different big mobsters moving into town, and how they deal with all those pressures. The Clark Park Gang are an infamous gang from East Vancouver that operated around the 1960s and 70s. They were not organized crime, they were disorganized crime. Everything really came to a head with the VPD after the Rolling Stones riot in 1972. So they're these infamous street guys from the 1960s and 70s. Sure, I was speaking with some real members of the Clark Park Gang, and one of them was Kim Brucker, who was a female member of the Clark Park Gang. And, you know, in history, a lot of time we erased women from different stories, but they were there. They were on the forefront. She was there kicking garbage cans down alleys just with the rest of them. Well, I want the LGBT community to know that I'm a queer playwright, and a lot of our cast and crew are queer as well, and that, you know, queer people belong in this genre, and they belong in all these stories, and oftentimes we are pushed aside into sort of our own genre, and, you know, the focus is the queerness, whereas the reality of it is we've always been here. We've lived through all of these eras. We've lived through all of these times. We were present in this time, and so what I really want is for the audience to feel like they belong here, too.
Behind my back, and he's a cop, but it's not a big deal. Well, fuck me, I guess.
For the casting of Sunrise Betty's, we held auditions and brought in, I believe it was over 75 people to come and see for the cast of this show. So it was an incredible experience of getting to see so many amazing actors and putting together a team of people that we believed could carry the show, had the integrity, and had the right chemistry with each other. I love our LGBTQ community here in Vancouver. I feel so lucky that there's many of us on this show that are in that community and get to support stories and queer narratives as part of this show. We talk a lot about the importance of showcasing queerness on stage and what queer touch and queer intimacy and queer love looks like. And so I'm really happy to invite a queer audience to come and see it.
You know she's not going to be okay with this. Look, I know what I'm doing, okay?
So Beth is the newest member of the Sunrise Betty's gang. She is young, she's queer, she is full of ambition, she cares deeply for the gang, and she does anything she can to protect them. She's also dating one of the other women in the show, Gwen. So they have this kind of secret, private, maybe private but not secret, relationship that kind of informs her entire journey through the show.
Well, I guess we could say the thug life chose them. I'm Emily Ann Fraser. You're watching Outlook TV Vancouver.
Coming up next, David gets a second helping at the Fabulous Theater.
Here's a show called Dim Sum Diaries Second Helping, including a couple of gym bros and their story in One Last Rep.
If you want your theater to be eclectic, bite-sized, and nourishing, then you might want to check out Dim Sum Diaries, A Second Helping.
I want to be seen for me, be liked for me, and be wanted for me. Me!
So Dim Sum Diaries 2 is like a sequel to Mark Laring Young's 1991 radio play, Dim Sum Diaries. Basically, what we did in this version is we took verbatim and some new material written by all Chinese-Canadian writers from across Canada, and we've refined it into these conversations about the perspective of being a Chinese Canadian. Everything from queer identity to being in a biracial family to understanding what it's like to be a Chinese Canadian medical profession. As a queer Chinese Canadian myself, I think that Min Lee's piece, who's the playwright of this particular piece, One More Rep, tries to talk about something that we as Chinese Canadians have dealt with, stigmatized for a long time, which is the whole sort of idea of no fats, no femmes, no Asians, which is kind of the grinder culture of typically white-presenting cis males sort of denouncing us as sexy or relevant or as someone that we want to find connection with or love, you know, just because of who we are. And of course, the pandemic didn't help and just like things like that. So I think it's really important to be able to showcase this story, to be able to show that like, yeah, this still persists even now.
Why am I being canceled on all the apps just because of my race?
Max is a Chinese Canadian guy, and he's in the gym and he's trying to work out. He's trying to get himself buffed to look good, look great, to be his ideal self. But then something happened with the personal trainer, and I'm not gonna give out many spoilers, but yeah, it's a story about self-discovery. It's about self-love and also self-hate, which is, I think, it's very universal, and I think everyone can resonate with that.
You're sick of being who you are, so you manifested me here to make you something you actually are.
So Kyle is, he's a bit of a gym bro. He's a personal trainer. He's also an unconventional sage of sorts to Max. One might say he's very similar to Max. The thing about this whole project is that it's taking local Asian playwrights and giving them a chance to see their plays brought to life. And in doing so, all the actors, we get to play multiple different roles in different monologues and plays.
So I want the audience to come here, watch the play, and after that, they would feel more self-accepted and just feel more self-love.
So you might want to get your tickets right away for Dim Sum Diaries, A Second Helping. My name's David C. Jones for Outlook TV.
Ugh, would you look at the time? That's all we have for today, but we will be back.
Why don't you grab your best squirrel friends in the meantime and check us out on all our social media platforms, or better yet, consider volunteering with us.
I'm Emily Ann Fraser.
And my name is T.
Stay fabulous, Canada.